coming to the final days of step cutting, and that left it as a kind of pinnacle of achievement at the time. But it's been distorted by this idea that it was very important and pivotal. I don't believe that for a minute.
The ascent continues next week with the climbing career of Tom Patey. At the same time, 8 o'clock, BBC Two.
Alan Partridge is mad. So is Kevin Day. And as for Larry Sanders, well, he caps it all. This Friday, join three mad men and a little dog.
You know what would make me happy right now?
What's that?
The dog. I want to go get the dog.
I don't know how to tell you this, but Jeannie stopped by earlier.
She did.
And she took the dog.
Entertainment for Friday on BBC Two. You'd be barking mad to miss it. The recipe for a social disaster.
You know mini Kievs?
Yeah.
On the menu, would they be under starters or main courses?
You've got to take it.
No, I think I'll need something a bit stronger.
The recipe for convenience. And innovation.
Think cheesy peas. It's easy peasy with cheesy peas. Please.
Fast food. No, all the ingredients for the Fast Show. Tuesday at 10 on BBC Two.
Waiting for God or just loitering with intent? Diana's looking for trouble. Again, on BBC One. On BBC Two, in half an hour, there's trouble afoot at the Abbott Mansion for the jittery Gene Wilder. A family conspiracy and Dom DeLuise in drag make for an interesting, if haunted, honeymoon. Now on BBC Two, the weekly wax from the team at Top Gear.
This week's Top Gear. New boy Russell bulging in Nissan's answer to the probe. New girl Vicky Butler Henderson racing an old Golf. And old boy Quentin Wilson on second-hand alfresco fun.
The 50s, a decade when pop socks were considered daring and people still said bother when they hit their thumb with a hammer. The music was awful, but the cars were worse. Chunky and drab.
So can you begin to imagine the effect that this car had on visitors to the Turin Motor Show in 1953?
It's called Bat 5, and it was the work of Franco Scaglione, a man who had learned his trade in Italy's aeronautical industry. Underneath, it's an Alfa Romeo, but on top, it's Thunderbird 4, Stingray, and Chuck Yeager's Bell rocket ship, all rolled into one. It may well have cleaved the air like a bullet, and sure, it was 15% faster than the Alfa Saloon on which it was based, but it was never going to be a production reality. After a quarter of a turn, the wheels were rubbing against the front wings. Visibility from that cockpit was poor. It's like being in a post box. And then there were the headlights. Or rather, there weren't.
So they tried again in 1954 with a new Berlinetta Aerodynamica Technica car. And I know what they said to Franco, but it must have been something along the lines of, look, me old mate, really let your hair down this time. Don't hold back. give us something really weird.
This is what they got. Bat 7, the craziest car that had ever been produced. By miles.
Ain't seen nothing yet. Baby, you just ain't seen nothing yet. Here's something that you're never gonna forget. Baby, you just ain't seen nothing yet.
Like Bat 5, it has a simple Alpha chassis with a simple 1900cc engine. So it's not exactly the road burner you might imagine.
Yes, it'll rev to 7,000 RPM, and yes, the motor has a brace of camshafts. But at 30 miles an hour, it feels like every single panel is about to fall off. I wasn't expecting it to feel as futuristic as it looks, but honestly, a horse with mustard on its parts is more refined than this. When this car lived in California in the early 1980s, some idiot actually raced it. Mind you, we also chopped the fins off, so he turned a nasty car to drive into an ordinary-looking one. Americans, eh? Geez.
Those fins, now back in their rightful place, may look like the creation of someone with little or nothing in his underpants, but they're there for two reasons. One, they give this car a drag coefficient of just 0.19, and nothing, even today, gets close. And two, Franco wanted to demonstrate that you could make great shapes out of metal. Radical thinking at the time. Again, and unsurprisingly, this car drew the crowds at the Turin Motor Show, but again, Alfa felt they could squeeze even more out of Franco.
Oh, bigger doors would have been nice. Now, in the early 50s, the Turin styling houses were famed for building bespoke motor cars for the wealthy individual. The idea of a manufacturer asking them to design so-called concept cars was new. And that kind of showed with Bat 5 and Bat 7. They were wild, but a bit woolly. The third attempt, though, Bat 9, that was a cracker.
It may not have been quite so far-fetched as its two predecessors, and at the 1955 Italian Motor Show, the crowds barely noticed it. But I think it's a little honey. There are shades of Corvette Stingray here, 8 years before America's first attempt at Buck Rogers styling first saw the light of day. But even the Vet is a wallflower compared to this.
It still isn't fast, because it still only has that 1900cc engine. But sitting here with the windscreen curling round and those huge fins disappearing off into the distance, it really does feel like it should have wings, like the speedo should be in max and not kph.
After Bat 9, Alfa severed its ties with Franco and went off to be a mass-market manufacturer. Franco died poor and tortured. Which is a shame, because in the mid-80s, a Japanese businessman paid $18 million for these three cars. And that's a rotten bit of luck for him, too, because they're now for sale at Coys of Kensington for just $4 million. Mm-mm.
This is the Rover 200 Coupe. It is chunky and impressively grown up. And this is the Fiat Coupe. It's chic enough to make you think of what a baby Ferrari could be like. The Ford Probe has got more curves than the Le Mans 24-hour race. It's butch, in a nice way. This is the new Nissan 200 SX, and it isn't any of these things.
Coupes are cars to fall in love with. They're not about practicality. If you want practical, drive a Montego. Coupes are all about suggesting that you're really quite a guy, or quite a girl, whichever. So a slightly dull coupe is a contradiction in terms. Welcome to the Nissan Contradiction in Terms, the 200 SX, the almost coupe.
It resembles the old 200SX with its last few remaining edges buffed smooth. All terribly grown up and yet trying a bit too hard. Like watching an aging uncle dance to Bad Boys Inc. The 200SX is almost too discreet, too polite for a car where look at me is just as important as raw performance and responsive handling. This car commands respect rather than inflaming passions.
But the 200SX has got a couple of things going for it, like the fact that the engine is in the front and the drive goes out to the rear wheels.
This is, of course, the way sports cars used to be before they were cloned from front-wheel drive underpinnings. There's nothing quite like a front-engine, rear-drive layout for giving crisp cornering, well-balanced handling, and a real sense of driver involvement. That's one key reason why the BMW 3 Series Coupe has such an enthusiastic following. Nissan should be applauded for going the rear drive route. It would have been easier to rebody a Primera and slap a 200SX badge on it. The trouble is that the steering is still a bit woolly and the ride isn't quite as supple as some rivals.
The 200SX feels a shade lifeless to drive. The car doesn't give you enough information, either through the steering or through the seat of your pants. That's acceptable in a turgid family saloon, but unacceptable in a sports coupe. And the interior is a bit, well, saloon-like. It's as well presented as an airline meal, and just about as memorable.
The seats are leather-trimmed, but everything else is plastic. This much plastic simply isn't sexy. However, every switch, lever, button and knob works with real precision.
The same confidence-inspiring feel that you find in a quality Japanese hi-fi.
The gear shift is light and crisp. The brakes are good. The 197 bhp turbocharged engine is sluggish low down but solid mid-range for easy overtaking. Top speed is claimed to be 146 miles an hour, with the 0-60 dash taking just under 7 seconds. On the right road, in the right mood, the 200SX almost kids you that it's a fun partner. But you won't get a warm feeling inside just from casting a furtive glance over it. When you talk about it, bulletproof reliability will crop up in your conversation before you mention good old-fashioned fun.
The 200SX is a nearly car, just like dungarees are nearly trousers and tofu is nearly food. Nearly, but not quite. Not quite isn't good enough for a sports coupe. It's like that other nearly coupe, the Vauxhall Calibra, which, in spirit, is nothing more than a cavalier in a designer shell suit.
And, until this summer, Calibra was Britain's best-selling coupe. Making a Calibra clone must have seemed like a smart move when Nissan was developing the 200SX.
But not now, because Calibra isn't top of the pops anymore.
Believe it or not, the market leader is the BMW 3 Series.
Which suggests that the coupe market is getting serious about offering driving satisfaction as well as real style. So, at around £20,000, the 200SX has really got a fight on its hands.
Now for news of the biggest automotive event of the year, the Motor Show at the NEC in Birmingham. We'll be there on the telly with Top Gear here on BBC Two and a 50-minute special over on BBC One. And you can meet us in person on our own stand. Call 021 780 4141 if you want more information on opening times and stuff like that. That's 021 780 4141. See you there.
Don't you just hate it when this happens?
But
There are ways for racing wannabes to burn rubber with impunity and in just the same cars that they drive on the road. The idea behind the Slick 50 Road Saloon Championship is kind of quaint. The rules stipulate that the cars must be driven to the circuit and, barring incidents, be driven home again. No trailers, no backup cars. Novel idea? Nope. Just think back to the days before marketing geniuses gave us Go Faster stripes and Envy badges, when the likes of Malcolm Campbell and Count Louis Zabrowski revved up impatiently behind horse and cart before a head-to-head at Brooklands. In fact, the idea is so simple that anyone can take part. The only proviso being you need one of these, a competition license. It costs £30, and providing you've passed an RAC circuit driving test, you can squeal the tires of your hot hatch on a real starting grid. But street legal is the name of the game, so first the car has to be scrutineered. You are allowed to tweak the engine, shocks and springs, but not a lot. And there are some essential safety mods needed, like a roll cage, fire extinguisher and an electrical cut-off device. But you won't necessarily need sponsorship or wedged-up parents, because a car in race trim can cost as little as £2,000. Golfs are a favourite choice because they handle well and there are lots of them about. I borrowed my Mark II from experienced competitor Paul Rose. I was only managing a pretty poor 15th in the qualifying session, so I decided to let Chris Wetherill slip by. Judging by his car, he looked as though he'd run into enough already.
The tyre wall, I mean, a perfectly innocent tyre wall just drove out behind me and hit me there. So, no, I mean, it's damaged. Realistically, I haven't got enough money to repair it properly.
Do you drive your car to and from work?
No, I don't. No. It's not a daily driver, so... not at all, because I mean the engine, I'm sure the engine would go off if you did use it every day.
Yeah.
But also, I mean, it just says please stop me all over it, realistically.
Do you get challenged at all out on the road?
God, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, it's really good. Yeah, it's quite good. Of course, you can't always take it up, but my aunt came with us to Alton Park a couple of weeks ago.
In the Golf?
Yeah, she travelled up in the Golf with me, and she spent most of the time giggling, clinging onto the ceiling. Oh, no.
Superb.
It's really good.
Yeah.
I love it.
I'm as nervous as I am excited, which I think can't be too bad. It is scary looking in my rear view mirror seeing all those cars behind me. Oh. 5 second board is up. Engines are revving. Red light. Appalling start. Of everywhere, get on the inside for panic. Oh man, what an absolute farce. Move out and I'm coming up your inside. Go on. Oh, don't miss me about, man. Come on, Vic. Come on, babe. Go. Yes, he's on the grass. Okay, we've done him. Come on. Go. This is more like it. Now, providing I don't muck up clearways, I'm in with a chance with at least the green gold here. Going into paddock. Got a man right up my chuff. He's alongside. Oh no, I can't believe this.
Nigel in the green Golf was using blocking tactics and then his reversing lights came on. That must be the ultimate dirty trick.
I was just coming up behind you, and all of a sudden I got these lights.
I put it in reverse. Yeah, no, I'm sorry about that. I didn't realise.
You certainly did protect your line. I mean, would it not have been a bit easier just to stick to your own line and let me go past?
Not if I'd have finished a place down, no.
But I was quicker than you, and I was.
Yeah, but I finished in front of you.
Well, I started 15th, and I finished 15th, and I had a terrific day.
And at least it's got rid of all my aggression for the Monday morning crawl to the office.
You know, I've been thinking, and I reckon that there's bikes and there are bikes. There's cars and there are cars.
There's motorhomes.
And there are motorhomes.
But who would live in a home like this?
Clues. He rides a motorbike. Pretty well. His initials are KS. He is Revving Kevin Schwantz, world 500cc motorcycle racing champion. And he spends his summers on the European circuit with his ma and pa, roughing it in a camper van.
Well, this is a Wonder Lodge made by Bluebird. It's 102 inches wide, which is, what, 8'6". It's approximately 13 feet high and 40 feet long. And then we also pull a trailer behind it, which makes our overall length approximately 60 feet.
Shirley, why does it need to be so big?
Well, it's mainly for Kevin to have at the paddock. Most all the riders have motorhomes to stay in. They don't have to then leave the circuit in the evenings, fight the traffic in the mornings, and actually during the racing from Thursday on, we stay in the hotel and Kevin stays here.
So this is like a little piece of Texas that you take with you, is it?
Yeah, I think we try to make it like that, yeah.
And I wanted to see deeper into its heart.
So, this is the lounge, and I think the word I'm looking for here is luxurious. But what do you do for entertainment, Jim? Sing song around the old campfire?
No, we don't have to do that. We've got something a little better than that. We've got full entertainment center here with satellite dish, VCR, surround sound processor, and that sort of thing.
So, just the bare necessities. But hey, what does half $1 million buy you these days?
Ice maker. Down here, you've got your microwave, your cooktop, your fridge. You've got the whole thing.
This fridge is bigger than some flats that I've rented. What have you got in it?
And not a lot. Well, we've got some necessities. The beer's in there, isn't it?
And after drinking all that, you'll be needing the bathroom. Straight off the set of Dynasty. Sorry, Dynasty. Back in the master bedroom, even the curtains are remote control.
Yeah, and I see we've got another widescreen television up here, Jim.
That is two of three TVs that we've got.
Did I miss one on the way down or something?
No, this one is in the outside entertainment center. You can pull this whole tray out like so, swivel the set around where you can watch it from all angles. And
very entertaining.
Yeah, works good, works good. We've got a clothes washing machine in a compartment.
Washing machine.
We've got a Barbie.
Barbie.
Toolkit.
Cuddly toy? No.
Right. Well, all right, Jim, I'm willing to concede that this is truly the most fabulous mobile home on the face of the planet. But is it mobile?
It certainly is. Would you like to take a drive?
I surely would.
Let's do it.
So off we ventured, a whale amongst minnows, towing our garage behind us along the winding byways of Great Britain.
Motorways and A roads, I feel pretty confident about. To get on a B road is a bit dodgy. You've got to know the B road, or I don't think you'd want to venture down it.
What engine have you got in this thing?
This is approximately a 12-liter Detroit diesel, turbocharged diesel, develops 500 horsepower.
Well, it pulls well up the hills.
It does a nice job.
It certainly does. But what kind of mileage does it get?
7 to 8 miles would be a good guesstimate.
And how much does it cost you when you come to the gas station and fill it up?
If we're empty, we can spend $1,000.
$1,000? I'll bet you collect your coupons, don't you?
Don't we just? Yeah.
Truly the home that has everything, from air conditioning to air suspension. But you know what impressed me most? The air horn.
Because the ultimate motorhome has got the ultimate horn. And it plays 99 different tunes. And according to the Ultimate Horn menu, bizarrely, in at 96, is the theme from Benny Hill. Hit it, Jim.
Thank you.
music shall caress you.
In America, they call it the Miata. And when it was launched in 1989, Mazda drove a prototype through the streets of Santa Barbara, followed by crowds of car-crazy Californians. It's since sold 300,000 examples, and the Americans think it's the next best thing to Budweiser. Here in England, we call it the MX-5, and this, its latest incarnation, comes with an all-new 1.8 engine. Available with airbag, ABS, power steering, immobilizers, and side impact beams, this is one little red roadster you can buy with your heart and your head.
In fact, I'd go even further and say that at a whisker over £17,000, this new MX5 1.8 IS is probably Britain's best value sports car. Not only is it as cute as lace panties, it boasts such sensible modernities as ABS, an airbag, and side impact beams. Never has panache been so practical.
A clever cocktail of Californian glam, Japanese reliability, and British trad. Mazda have made sure the MX-5 oozes character from every seam. That gruff MGB-like engine note is quite deliberate. The jiggly ride quality takes you back 20 years, and like all traditional convertibles, there's more noise in the cabin than at a status quo concert. But it's all part of that vintage charm.
And if you can't find 17 grand, the best news is that the MX-5 is tough enough to make even more sense second-hand. For the much more affordable sum of £8,000, you could be flitting between parties in this pretty little G-plater. Hardly what you'd call mad money for a proper mess-your-hair-up sports car with turnkey reliability. And that's another thing. The MX-5 is as dependable as Douglas Hurd.
But let's ask a man who handles MX-5s every day.
In terms of their reliability and any problems associated to MX-5, I have to say, and not what you want to hear, there are no problems with the car. They're extremely reliable, and all they require is regular maintenance.
The main problem is availability. There are very, very few of them around. How is that going to affect buyers?
Well, availability of the car, as you see, I don't have one here. We've had one used MX-5 this year. And they are extremely scarce, so a very good example is a very difficult commodity to find.
And how does that affect the prices?
Well, it generally keeps the prices of the cars very buoyant and very high, and so, as I say, if you're buying a late car, just be very careful that you don't pay too much money for it.
Splendidly classless, when friends ask how much your MX-5 cost, just lie. They'll never know.
Do you know what this car is?
Yeah, mine's an MX-5.
Now, it's a G registration, it's done about 40,000 miles. Hazard a guess as to what it might cost.
That's seven and a half grand.
No, I don't know what this car is.
Sports car.
A sports car.
It's a Mazda MX-5.
It's done 40,000 miles. What do you think it would cost? A rough guess.
9 or 10,000.
About £10,000.
Between 14 and 16.
I think it's about 17,000.
20,000.
25,000.
25 grand. About £30,000.
What would you say if I said it cost £8,000?
£8,000? I think you were joking.
I think it's wonderful.
If it is, I want one.
If it all sounds too good to be true, I have to say that the MX-5 does have a couple of shortcomings, and the first is second-hand prices. It's easy to pay 12.5 grand for a two-year-old car, sometimes even more if the yellow orb is shining. But what you need to remember is that the new entry-level 1.8i is only a couple of thousand more, 14.5, and that's for a brand spanking new car. So don't be seduced into paying silly sunshine prices. The second downside is the MX-5's considerable envy factor. We were going to film this silver car, but last night, some deadhead from the planet Dork busted the window and boosted the music. We can't blame the car for urban anarchy, but you do need to be careful where you park your suburban trinket. That apart, the MX-5 is a smile a minute.
Ha ha ha!
It is simply brilliant to drive. The rifle bolt gear change snicks satisfyingly, the power steering is just right and pin sharp, and the chassis balance is virtually perfect. I love it!
Let the dream begin!
With 15% more power from the new 1.8 16-valve twin-cam engine, it can scamper along at a very lively lick indeed and say hello to an awfully naughty 120 miles an hour.
A cracker when it was launched, the new refined MX-5 is now even better and rightly deserves all the superlatives going. Next week, Audi's Aluminium Super Saloon, Mason on the Ulster Rally, and looking back to a golden era of American motoring before all those fins got in the way.
And there's a feature on top designer Franco Scaglione in the October issue of BBC Top Gear magazine.
A close encounter of the third kind.
Four sightings in 1967.
Ah! Ruby's gone!
They took her, didn't they, Mr. Mulder?
It's coming from there.
How can an eight-year-old boy be a threat to national security? Something was out there in those woods.
The X-Files, Monday at 9:30 on BBC Two.
"'Twas brillig, and the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves, and the mome raths outgrabe. Beware the Jabberwock, my son, the jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the Jubjub bird, and shun the frumious Bandersnatch. He took his vorpal sword in hand, long time the manxome foe he sought. So rested he by the tum-tum tree, and stood awhile in thought. And as in uffish thought he stood, the Jabberwock, with eyes of flame, came whiffling through the tulgey wood and burbled as it came. One, two, and through the vorpal blade went snicker-snack. He left it dead, and with its head he went galumphing back. And hast thou slain the Jabberwock? Come to my arms, my beamish boy. O frabjous day, calloo-callay, he chortled in his joy. 'Twas brillig, and the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves, and the mome raths outgrabe.
On BBC Two now, it seems that horror begins at home. A haunted honeymoon awaits the unsuspecting Gene Wilder.
It's not what you think. Ugh. Well, it's partly what you think, but, oh, it's so complicated.